People are getting killed, people are getting kidnapped, people have fled their homes.
After 17 long years, it's a war much of the world seems to have forgotten. Except, of course, the victims. Their families still caught up in the horror.
My uncle also fled in a state of chaos in order to save his life and his family's life.
My grandfather and the other hostages, they were tortured by the Taliban.
In recent months, the Taliban's ramped up its violent attacks in areas of Afghanistan, which had been relatively peaceful. Their main target, Hazaras, a religious minority with a long history of persecution.
Hazaras are actually seen as infidels in the eyes of the Taliban.
The Hazaras have emerged as a political force. So the Taliban recognize this, and as a result, they want to squash any progress the Hazaras make.
Sadiqa Karimi says her grandfather, a community elder in the district of Jaguri, and her 12-year-old cousin were taken hostage after being lured into negotiations with the Taliban.
My cousin says that they were kept hungry and they were tortured, because the Taliban wanted to know if they are associated with any government groups.
The pair was eventually freed and were able to flee to Kabul.
The only thing they had with them was the clothes that they had on.
It's a similar story for Besmela Rezaei's uncle and his 8 kids.
He and his family managed to get to Kabul in the cold winter, and now they don't know if they can ever go back to Jaguri.
Around 60% of people in Jaguri and Malistan have been forced to leave everything they know.
The towns and villages that were thriving have now turned into ghost towns.
The recent attacks that have rocked their villages started in Khazuristan, a district of Uruzgan province where our troops fought and died to maintain peace and stability.
We went in there to fight combatants who were killing innocent people. We were doing good, and people were able to live reasonably normal lives in areas that the coalition dominated.
Former Special Forces Sergeant Paul Kale was deployed to Afghanistan 5 times before combat operations ceased in 2014.
We knew it would be the case that once we left certain areas, like where we operated out of Uruzgan, that's now controlled by Taliban.
The Taliban now contests or controls almost half of the country.
The Afghan security forces are stretched thin. There are mounting casualties.
The Taliban shouldn't be underestimated. They are strong and hard fighters. They would kill anyone, and it's horrific what they do. I've seen women, children, an old man murdered, people killed for simply being in the wrong place or being seen as not supporting the Taliban.
What Paul saw over there still haunts him today. So news reports the security situation is getting worse are hard to cop.
To see that, it's frustrating. And to be honest with you, I avoid seeing too much of it. All I can do is become angry.
Hazaras living here say Australia's legacy there is unravelling.
All of the good work of the Australian government, aid and development programme, as well as military missions, will be undone, essentially, if there is no action taken.
That's what's at stake.
That's what's at stake.
There are still about 300 Aussies working over there, not so much on the front line, but training and mentoring Afghans to run their own war.
To completely pull out of Afghanistan is probably, to be frank, would probably mean genocide for the Hazara people. And the fact that we're still there means that our politicians have an understanding of how important it is.
In a statement to the project, the Defence Department says the Australian government constantly reviews its commitment to Afghanistan in line with our national security priorities and in order for the deployed personnel to complete their mission successfully.
I don't think Australians have an appetite to return to Afghanistan to the levels of what we've done before. But I also think Australia has a commitment to making sure that we don't see the genocide and mass migration through complete withdrawal.
The international community cannot afford to let Afghanistan go at it alone. Australia can definitely help by not sending back Hazara asylum seekers and refugees, because that will only add to Hazaras and minorities' insecurity.
The US is leading peace negotiations with the Taliban in the hope of ending this long-running war. But so far, the Taliban has reportedly refused to hold direct talks with any Afghan officials.
We can stabilise, but I don't know how all the parties can reconcile. That's an incredible mission for diplomats to achieve.
And until that happens, Hazara is in Australia, urging us not to forget the innocent families caught in the crossfire.
Seeing the home country fall apart and you not being able to do anything, it's disturbing.
This is an invisible humanitarian crisis that's happening. The scale of devastation is very large and it needs immediate national and international attention.
I guess the point is, I know that we've left, our soldiers have left largely, and we think of it as their war, but remember that it was the West. It was us, part of the coalition that went in 2001 and started this war. And we promised to do three things: to bring democracy, to get rid of the Taliban and stop it from being used by terrorists as a base. We haven't achieved any of those things on the current state of play. And I think we've got to remember that we do have some responsibility. Mm.